late August and September, and summer, I guess, this year. So how are your tomatoes doing?
Not
they are very good. Well, in some cases, they're doing all right. It depends on where you live. We live in South Hill, which is south of Seattle, up on the hill. And we had to plant our tomatoes the first week in June this year because we had temperatures that were freezing at night. And tomatoes don't like that, do they? So I'm here today to try to answer any questions that you might have. So just start giving them to me. Yes, good morning. Did you all hear that? She planted carrots, and they grew, she could see the top of the crown of the carrot. And then when she pulled them up, there was nothing below, or not much below. So what did she do wrong? There are several different types of carrots, so you want to be sure that it's the right kind of carrot, first of all, because we have the little round carrots, you know. And we also have the baby or finger type carrots. So those are not going to have much below the ground. So variety will be most important. But when the carrot does not develop, usually there is something in the soil below them, or there is something that has been given. It oftentimes is already in the soil, and it can be some form of a fungicide or an insecticide or a herbicide that has been used in the soil prior to the time that you planted that affects the growth of the carrot. So without knowing more about it, and maybe when we get here I can ask you a few questions and even narrow that down and give you a little bit more information. I would suspect that it would be an herbicide that probably would have effect. Yes, ma'am. What's the best way to get rid of ivy? It's an invasive, of course, plant, and her neighbors have planted, now it's coming into her yard. I have a perfect answer for that, and it works every time. A stick of dynamite about that. No, actually, that does not work. You know, they used a stick of dynamite on a dandelion. Actually, where the dandelion was planted, with the stick of dynamite, the dandelion still came back. So that's not going to solve your ivy situation either. The best thing, of course, is that if you possibly can, is to stop at the property line and put in a barrier. And the barrier can be even 40 mil polyethylene down, and you want it about a foot deep to keep it. And I know that's a lot of work, but that will, it'll still also come over that barrier if you're not careful. So it's just a tedious, continual job. If you use some kind of an herbicide, then that's going to take it back and eliminate the plant probably at its source, but you're doing contamination at the same time. And that's, you know, in this day and age, really not acceptable. Yes?
I've got some treated wood laying around. I was wanting to build some more raised beds. Is there any proof that treated material leaches into the ground and do vegetables pick it up then?
Yeah, treated wood is a question in this particular case. And he has some around that he wants to use as raised beds. Is there any proof then that is still, you know, is treated wood good to use or is it not good? And it depends upon what kind of treated wood it is and who the manufacturer is. And maybe you can trace it back to where you purchased the wood. because some of the treatments are safe, some that were done early on are not.
Well, this is fairly new, but probably Home Depot.
Okay. Okay, find out what the company is, what company it is. It's probably womanized, and does it? Yeah, still, it depends on the company that has the formula that they're using. And then call their 800 number. And don't take the word of the clerk. They don't know. Yeah. So you want to be sure that you go back to the source, and you will almost invariably find an 800 number for them, contact them, ask them, and they're liable if they, you know, have given you any, and it's not to their advantage to do that anymore.
So if I get cancer 20
years, they're not. Yeah, right, if you get cancer 20
years. Worst case scenario is, or I just don't go to that problem, could I just paint it or something?
No.
No,
the thing that you would want to do, if you still want to use and you're not safe or you're not confident that you've gotten the right information, or you're still, you still want to be doubly sure that you're safe, is to line the inside of the treated wood with polyethylene or some other type of protective material. Yeah. And people will often use railroad ties. Well, railroad ties, you know, that's creosote and that's carcinogenic. We never do that. So, but the treated woods, most of them are safe. There is a firm, I understand, in fact, now at Eatonville, Washington, the treatment is all organic or natural. And it is a 30 or 35 year guarantee. Product treatment. So if you're looking for new treated wood, you know, that type of, that would be a good source. Yes, sir. Good way to do soil testing. They have, here for sale, they have the little kits, the soil test kits that you can buy and test them yourself. Or there is a soil testing company in Belmont that you can send. Of course, it costs money to do it, but nevertheless, you can have it done that way. So you can believe either way. Yeah, just actually get the soil test kits and test it. It depends on what you're testing for, because in some cases, there's a little probe that you can put in the soil, and it will read the nitrogen, for example, that's in the soil in a specific area. So there are different types of, in addition to using the liquids, is what I'm saying, there are probes that can be used for testing. Okay?
Ed?
Yes.
What degree does the home gardener, let's be certain, really need the detailed test kit? In other words, to send it in and get the detailed thing. Is that more for large farmers than...
Yes. That's a very good question, Baron. Thank you. And that is, how important is it for you as a home gardener to go to the problem or the trouble of actually testing the soil, going to the full, sending and getting a complete soil test kit is what I'm trying to say. I've only been gardening full time for 62 years, and we've lived in six different places, and I've yet to have the soil ever tested. Yes, it's just a matter of really, Gary, you bring up a very good point, because it's just a matter of really taking a little bit of time and improving the soil wherever you're working. And if you're bringing in soil, it's very, very important, I think, that you don't get on the phone and call up a company and say, would you deliver truckload of soil, or would you deliver a yard of soil? Don't do that. If you go out and you look at the soil, because so often what you think or what they think is a good soil is not a good soil at all. So by all means, always look at it, run it through your fingers, and make sure that, you know, that it's a top quality soil. Otherwise, you're paying a big price and your truck may not be getting much at all. Yes? Does the same hold true for mulch? I definitely would do. I do it myself, always. Yeah, I always go. And I say I always do it, and our general manager ordered some mulch. Thank you for bringing that up. Ordered some mulch, actual whole truckload. So we got 16 yards of mulch. It was terrible. You know, actually the worst stuff that we ever had, and I've been fighting it all year. You know, so it's just not worth it at all. And had anybody looked at it, or had he looked at it, you know, that would not have taken place at all.
Did you fire him?
No. No, you've been with us for 30 years, and it was just a mistake. You know, yes.
I'm not sure I want the answer to this question, but
okay.
I have a horrible area that's clay, gravel, sand, and rocks, okay? And I just made it into a garden with lots of neighbors. So I've done big holes and put real nice dirt and mulch and compost and bed in it. So will the roots eventually get out and really go into this horrible ground that's surrounding my vertical hole?
Well, let me answer it this way. One of the first places that Vernon and I owned, actually was the second place we owned. We lived in Edmonds and then we moved to Lakeland. And we moved into rock, glacial rock. I mean, just 95% rock. And I added the topsoil and worked with it and peat moss and other additives to the ground, and I could put anything. So I think you'll find that it sounds like you're a good enough gardener that you can prepare the soil properly, and I know you'll be able to grow anything you want in that kind of soil. Positive. Okay. Okay. Sure. Is what she mentioned is that she digs into the soil all of her garden or her kitchen waste. So she's adding all that organic humus to the garden. And does that change then the pH of the soil or the consistency of the soil? Absolutely. But I wouldn't worry. It's all good. So none of it's bad. So that's the key. And yes, best thing you can possibly do. Absolutely. Yes, ma'am. Okay, what's the best way to kill tree stump? There's actually a product on the market. It's called stump remover that you can, in fact, I'm sure they have it here at Furney's. Or you can use saltpeter. Saltpeter can also be diluted and used as a means of killing stumps. And I have the formula for that on our website, which is humeseeds.com. Hume, H-U-M-E, seeds. Don't, not my name, not it, but humeseeds.com. No, vinegar is not strong. Vinegar does a good job on weeds and grasses and things like that. And if there was moss or algae, for example, on this surface, the vinegar would do a good job for that. But no, it won't do it stuff. Yes, sir.
You're talking about the soil and mulch. Go see it.
Yes.
What are you looking for?
Well, you know, if you don't feel, he said, if I mentioned touching the soil, running it through your hands, looking at it. What do you look for? That is the question. And if you don't feel confident about, geez, I don't know what I'm even looking for, try to get somebody that is a good gardener to go with you and take a look at it. That's probably the best thing. But it's what we're looking for is something that is not subsoil. Too often, some of these soil mixtures and some of the places that you're buying soil are what is called subsoil. Topsoil has already been used, so they're down, you know, 4 or 5 feet down in the ground, and it's just junk, to say the least. Clay, it's clay or hardpan type soil in balls, you know, very often. You don't want, if you're adding a good topsoil to the garden, you want good quality. Something you can run through your hands. And when I say run through your hands, then it's not a big clay ball or anything of that nature. But yes, you know, don't hesitate. You know, the people are really pleased if you ask them, you know, a neighbor that's a really good gardener, would you, or grandma or grandpa or mom or dad or, you know, anyone like that, they are pleased that you have enough confidence in them as being good gardeners that you want them to give you a helping hand. And usually they won't charge you. Yes. Do I have any hints for getting rid of horsetail? No. That is the one plant that you might want to use an herbicide on. Yeah. In there, I have used an herbicide. I have had it coming in from the neighbors. And in order to stop it so it would not come in, I used an herbicide that worked very well. It's no longer on the market, but I found a second one that does work. And it's a Bayer product, B-A-Y-E-R. And Bayer, of course, is a pharmaceutical company. And it's their blackberry vine and brush cut. Yeah. And that worked out very good. And what I did in that particular case is I mixed it up. I put a little bit of a tablespoon, in fact, of liquid detergent soap from the kitchen sink as a spreader sticker. And then I painted it on so that I wasn't contaminating any of the surrounding areas at all. So I painted it on and it worked out just beautiful. Did a magnificent job of controlling. Yes.
Do you hold with the idea that properly finished compost makes your hands dirty? Tests.
Yes. And it's one of the tests of whether it's good or not. Absolutely. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Should you be concerned about removing compost from And the thing is that you may want to ask them, whoever you're buying it from again, is to ask them what their source is, how long that the compost has been decomposed, and if it's not over 9 months to a year time, it probably not used. or set it aside in chemicals. Yeah. And if you're using any kind of an herbicide, the same rule applies. So use your compost for 9 to 12 hours.
I haven't used anything
in the yard to get bad bugs, it's all working. There you go, yeah. Isn't that what grandma and grandma used to do? You know, I think. Yes, stinging nettles are not only a pain in the neck, they're a pain in a few other places. Yes.
What's the question?
Oh, I'm sorry, stinging nettles. Remind me if I don't repeat it because I meant to. And she has 5 acres, you know, so they're coming in like crazy from the neighbors. She's trying to maintain them and pulling them and taking care of them. But the neighbors are not, so they're continually coming in. And anyone that has stinging nettles know how many seeds develop on them, that it can be a major, major problem. She's probably doing the best thing she possibly can without using some kind of herbicide. Yeah, just actually pulling them up. Is what we did in one area of our garden where they were on the hillside, and we were not growing any plants in that area at all, is that we used a Roundup on them, which cleaned them out, and then we put straw down over that area where no more nettles came in at all. Yes. Yeah. Right, exactly. She said that she can't do that because she has wetlands on the one side, and that's totally understandable. That's why I mentioned we did that on a hillside. It had no effect at all on anything else. Yes, ma'am. She drastically pruned it so that they can get the pears off of the tree. Well, I know exactly what you're talking about. We have a pear tree that got a little bit too tall that we didn't take care of, and actually it was on the property before we moved in. And we had the same problem. You know, how tall a ladder can you have? So that tree can be pruned quite drastically. The problem that we get, and you'll have to kind of work with the tree, is that when we do drastic tree pruning, that stimulates growth. And all of a sudden that 80-foot tree that say you prune back to 40 feet will have water sprouts on it. So you've got to deal with those water sprouts and work with the tree a bit. And actually reshape it. So it's a little bit of a, it's quite a project, but at the same time you can get it down. And I would say about up to 50%. So you can get it down to 40.
What's the best time to do that?
And the best time to do that, any of the stone fruits, the severe pruning should be in the autumn. Any of the non-stone fruit, such as pears and apples, we do in January, February. That's the best time to spray. Best time to spray out as well. Yes, ma'am. How do I feel about tiger? We use it all the time. We use the compost, and we use it in the vegetables because it's been cleared by the Tacoma Health Department. I'm trying to think of the right department. The Tacoma Health Department, and it can be used, according to them, to grow vegetables. Can be used in the vegetable. How much do we use? We mix it with the vets already, so we're probably only using about a third or two-thirds of already existing soil. And we do that every year.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Someone was telling you that she won't use it because they can't get rid of pharmaceuticals.
No, I don't. But it has been, I know it has been tested by the Tacoma Health Department and probably by the state too. That I don't know. But usually the state gets involved as well. So, yeah. And here again, if you have any questions like that, it's a very good question. If you have any questions similar to that, I would call not Agro, but call the health department and say, I understand that you have tested the product and what are the results? Or can I do this? Am I safe as far as pharmaceuticals are concerned? And that's a so, very good. Yeah, most of the waste management products end up, I believe, in King County out at
Cedarville.
Out at
so they make that Cedarville
compost? Yeah, it's heated, you know, in the process of decomposition. And there again, I'm sure it's tested by the state. Either by the county or the state. But yeah, again, go to the source. You know, don't go to the source, go to who's doing the testing. Absolutely. Anybody else? Hey, this you know, the new trend in gardening over the past 10 years. 10 years ago, our seed company had 50% of the seed varieties were flowers, and 50% were vegetables. Today, 75% are vegetables, and 25% are flowers. So, wow, the nutritional value that you get from vegetables grown fresh in your own garden. And I love to hear the questions that you folks have asked today, because that indicates to me, and I'm sure to the rest of you as well, that you're really getting involved in growing your own. And how important it is to get that fresh nutritional value from the garden, rather than to have things that have been sitting around for any length of time. And we have an educational garden. At our facility, 14 small gardens in one. And we try to make it fun because, for example, in one section of the garden, we have approximately 18 puns in it. Let me just give you one idea. We have, for example, in the garden, a telephone. And that telephone, we have it down on the soil. I take and dial in the number, and then I take the receiver and I put it to a flowering plant. What would you call that? I gave you half of the answer already. Call a flower.
Oh.
See? And we have another one, for example, where we have hands on a tree. What would you call that?
Palm tree.
Palm tree. Oh boy, you're smart, see? All right. So anyhow, we have about 18 of those in this one garden. We have another garden that has all plants that eat insects. So we have sarracenas and the pitcher plant and you know, plants of that nature, and it gives us an opportunity to tell people how to grow them and how much fun they are to grow, but try to make gardening fun. And the key is to get the kids involved. And I'd like to share with you just this little tidbit. The most important thing you know, and I know, is that kids don't have a very long attention span. So, encourage them to grow things that grow quickly. And one of them is a radish. In the kind of weather that we have right now, a radish will be up in 3 days. And you'll see the foliage. And you'll have that radish edible within probably 3 weeks or a little bit more. So that's really quick. They see the results immediately. That's what I hope you'll do. Encourage the kids to get involved in gardening. And in fact, you know why several years ago I talked to our staff into taking on a radish variety that's called watermelon radish. The outside is white, the inside is red. Exactly the opposite of radishes. But the name. See, I saw so many times kids with their parents run to the seed rack and grab a watermelon packet or grab a cantaloupe crowd packet. Do you realize how long it takes them to even grow from the seed? And do they ever ripen? Well, sometimes, most of the time, no. But in 3 days, they can see the radish inside. And the name is there, the watermelon. See, so that's the key. Varieties and things that get kids involved in, and then you've got a gardener for you.
And get those kind of one more question.
Okay, one more question. Yes?
Do I still have time to plant spinach seeds?
Do you have still time to plant spinach seeds? Carrots, kale, lettuce. Winter lettuce, particularly beets, yes. Get them in right away, though. And I say yes, it depends upon the weather. You know, not the weather man, but the weather. Okay. Thanks very much. Remember, our relationship with the planet today is tomorrow's future. Thanks very much.